Okay, class, welcome back to part two of the review for exam number one. All right, so we said that a price change doesn't cause a shift. So you say, okay, what does? All right, now, again, remember, whatever it is, if it shifts the supply or demand curve towards the right, that means more. If it shifts it to the left, that means less, okay? So, quickly, now, and you folks can do a little study on your own, explaining these, but what shifts demand? Well, national income. If national income rises, well, you know, in general, everybody has more money, so people will spend more. That will cause the demand shift to shift to the right, okay? Price change of a related good, we won't go into too much detail, but all I want to say is that it's not the price change of the good we are looking at, all right? It would be a price change of, let's say, Levi's and khakis. That's has been an example. Those are substitute goods. Well, if we were just looking at Levi's, and we had a price change of Levi's, we'd be going back to the movement along supply and demand curve. But we're not talking about the price change of Levi's. We're talking about a related good, a substitute good, meaning khakis. Now, if the price of khakis just, you know, went up, all different sorts of khakis, quantity demanded for khakis would go down. But the folks who are by Levi's, they're going to want more, and they're going to want more at every price level, okay? Because they were buying all sorts of khakis, but now khakis are more, so it's going to be a shift because that related good went up in price, all right? You don't have to spend too much time on that one because I know we didn't spend a lot of time on that ourselves, but let's at least mention it, okay? Preferences, tastes, or styles. You know, those are always changing. People, you know, they have a particular item that's very popular. Manufacturers try, boy, if it's all of a sudden their good got very popular, what they'll try to do is try to keep that shift, you know, as far right as possible and not go back. But a lot of times it's a fad, they shift, and again, at every price level, but typically they end up shifting back, okay? Expectations. If we as consumers are expecting down the road, 4 months from now, a big increase in something that we were going to buy, we were planning on buying, chances are we would buy it now, okay? We talked about bicycles, and it could be bicycles at every price level. If we anticipated bicycles in general are going to be more expensive 4 months from now, at every price level, let's say we all were buying different bikes, at every price level, if we thought it was going to be a lot more expensive 3.5, 4 months from now, we'd buy it now, all right? That would shift demand to the right, okay? So, expectations. Number of consumers, that's pretty easy. If there's more of us, more demanders, it's going to shift to the right. When World War II broke out, took 12 million men and women out of our economy, that's going to shift demand to the left. And it just stands to reason. You've got 12 million less folks buying stuff, okay? Excise or sales tax typically takes money out of our pocket. When money is taken out of our pocket, that's not a real toughie. We end up buying less, all right? That will shift demand to the left. Okay, now supply shift. Cost of inputs. That's something to do. A lot of these are related, some verbatim, but Some are not word for word. Now, cost of inputs. When you have a business, what do? You use inputs to make output, right? If your input costs are going up, well, you're going to make less output, okay? So if your inputs are going up, you're going to make less. So that's going to shift supply to the left. It would be somewhere like national income. I mean, if national income dropped, we would have less money, which shift demand to the left, okay? Price change of related goods, same thing. It's not the good that we're looking at, it's a related good, either a substitute or a complement. That can cause a shift. Technology. Technology almost always will shift supply to the right, okay? Expectations. Expectations is just the reverse of the expectations for you and I as consumers. If we're producing things and we think the price is going to be higher in 4 months, well, we're not gonna, you know, run like crazy this month, next month, next month, you know, filling up a warehouse with a lot of expensive inventory. We may cut back. We may tell our folks to take time off, relax, take the vacations now. Because 4 months from now, we are going to be ramping up big time to take advantage of that new higher price. So it's just the opposite, okay? What do we have? Number of suppliers, again, pretty self-evident. More suppliers shifts it to the right, less suppliers shifts supply to the left. And taxes also always shifts supply to the left, okay? Now, generally speaking, real quick, when demand shifts, typically gives us one good thing, one bad thing. Either way, if it shifts to the right, it gives us more quantity being transacted for. We go from here to here, so the economy is heating up, which is good. Bad thing is, the prices are going to be going up. See, we quantity transacted for is going up, but the price level is also going up. So one good thing, one bad. If it shifts to the left, well, the problem is we are slowing down, but at least prices are coming down a bit. So that's a help. Supply, on the other hand, either gives you two good things or two bad. And normally we think of supply shifting always giving us two bad. Supply shifting to the right, new technology, new oil, the internet actually coming full bloom into our economy will shift this to the right, meaning more things being transacted for and at a lower price. That's the best of both worlds. This is the worst of both worlds. This is, we are shifting. When we got hit, creamed in the 70s with a double huge oil hit, you know, input prices were skyrocketing. You know, companies were having a real hard time. So we were making less, but at the same time, since so many things were more expensive, we were actually experiencing quite high inflation, okay? All right, and we're gonna move on now. Demand elasticity, all right. What is elasticity? It's responsiveness. Whether it's the response of a consumer or a supplier, or you and I, if our income goes up. And all it means is, was there a big response? That means elastic. Was there a one-to-one response? And this goes for supply and demand. Well, it's a unitary. You know, the price went up. You know, the quantity demanded went down about the same amount. Okay, unitary. Or if a price change happened, was there little or no response? Well, if there's little or no response, and remember, when we're talking about response, we're talking about a quantity response. So when we are looking at elasticities, if we see an inelastic curve, meaning it's just going up and down, it's not moving this way, that's inelastic, okay? This would be relatively one-to-one, and this means totally elastic. Huge, huge change, okay? So that's what elasticity is response to this. Now, what causes this? You may want to remember the five basic ones are, you know, first one, availability of close substitutes. That's typically the number one. I mean, if you can get a substitute for that good that's gone up in price, well, what the heck? You're gonna switch over to the substitute, all right? But if there are no substitutes, you know, God forbid you have a rare disease and there's only one drug for it, well, you're stuck. It's gonna be an inelastic demand. You know, we're stuck with buying that no matter what happens to the price. See, the price can go up as much as it wants. We're not going to respond by buying less, all right? Now, two, is the good a necessity, a comfort, or a luxury? The more it has to do with being a necessity, the more inelastic it will be. Comforts are in that unitary area where, you know, price going up, quantity demand going down about the same. Luxury, on the other hand, they would probably be more elastic. I mean, if you had a great job, but all of a sudden there was a big cut in your company and you took a huge, you were still doing okay, but you took a big wage cut, probably the first thing you would cut were some of the luxuries. Maybe you'd have to sell that big summer house up north. Maybe you could still have a nice little summer cabin, but you would cut back first on the luxuries, okay? So whether the good is a necessity, luxury, or comfort depends on it. The share of income you spend, if you're not spending much, if it's a real small percentage of your income, you're not gonna change your purchasing. You buy a spice for $2 every Christmas. This Christmas it went up to $3. You know, it's not gonna affect you. You're still gonna buy it. But it was a big item, a car, a home, then it really becomes something you have to look at, because that's a big chunk of your income, all right? Time, and this is true for both supply and demand, always makes things more elastic. Why? Because you're given more opportunity to think of ways to get around this big price increase. You know, whether it's a rise in gas and you decide to carpool or take public transportation, or, you know, however you want to do it, time always makes things more elastic, okay? And then how the market for a good is defined. And that's basically saying, okay, when we're talking about housing, are we talking about just shelter, to give us shelter from the elements? Well, that's a necessity. I mean, if you're defining it just as shelter, you're going to have a rather inelastic demand curve. But if you're defining a home as it's got to be a six-bedroom mansion, well, that's a different story. So it depends on how you're defining the market, okay? Factors affecting supply elasticity, that's a little easier. Number one, availability of inputs and at what price. If you're making aluminum pistons for Ford and they called you up and said, hey, we want you to make a lot more, and you were running these little aluminum parts, like, man, well, you'd have to say, well, let me check with Alcoa and see, you know, because we just about machined all the raw aluminum on the floor, we're almost out. We have to see if that aluminum is coming in soon. Even if it's not, even if there is, if they say, no, we can't supply you for a couple of weeks, and you look around at the aluminum, what they call warehouses, typically their prices are quite a bit higher. So then you have to also look at the availability of the input and its price. I mean, because if the price is three times higher, especially with something like aluminum, because that is a costly item when you're making an end product, you know, that's going to affect your response. And if it's just too much, you're not going to respond. It's going to be inelastic, okay? Last one for that is time. And again, more time, more elastic. Okay, the three interventions in the market with the government, aside from government fiscal policy and monetary policy, which are the really big ones, which we're going to really get into some macroeconomics after this first exam. It really gets to be a lot more fun. But we'll go with price ceilings, price floors, and quotas. Now remember, a price ceiling, it's the upper limit. The price wants to go beyond it, but it can't. It's the upper limit that is allowed by the government, okay? Now, a price ceiling, all we have to remember is it goes exactly where you think a ceiling shouldn't go. You can put a price ceiling anywhere you want, okay? But if a price ceiling is where you think it should be, as above equilibrium, it doesn't really mean anything. For a price ceiling to be binding, it has to be below equilibrium, okay? As we talked about with the apartments in New York, if they were going for $1,500 and that was the equilibrium price, well, a price ceiling of $4,000 way up here doesn't really mean anything because the equilibrium price is here at $1,500. But if you go below equilibrium, as our example was where the price was $800, then you have a binding price ceiling. And remember, it's an upper limit. It can't go above. Now, it wants to, the market wants to push it up, but it can't. And it creates this black wedge, dead weight loss. Nobody gets it, all right? Run through them real quick. The problems would be reduces the quantity below efficient level, because here's what folks want, but we are cut back to here because that's where it hits the supply curve. So there's less quantity available. Misallocation of goods, meaning folks who need and deserve the apartments or the whatever good it is, they're not getting it. The people who can more than afford it, it's not a big sacrifice, they've got it. So misallocation of goods, all right? Wasted resources. You've got people, families running around spending time, energy, effort, money, trying to find a decent apartment in New York. I mean, there's so much wasted effort in terms of trying to find a decent place. That is also a problem, okay? There's an inefficiently low quality because, again, our rent controls, they're not going to keep the building up. They don't want the tenants to be happy and stay, you know, as a lot have done in New York. They want them to move because once they move, the rent control can be lifted off that apartment. So they keep the buildings in somewhat disrepair, almost borderlining into the negligent area, okay? And black markets, that's where you've got a rent control apartment, you're gonna move out of town for a while, you sublet it to somebody else, kind of split the difference, they get a deal, you get a deal. The only person not getting a deal is the apartment owner, okay? That is illegal, it does happen. All right. But it's got to be price ceiling. Remember, it has to be below equilibrium. Now, price floor is just the opposite, okay? Price ceiling was the upper limit. Price wants to go above the ceiling, but it can't. Price floor, the price wants to go down below the floor, but it is the absolute lower limit, that it can go. If it was the market without the government, the market would cause pressure to build and we would move down towards equilibrium. And again, a price floor, you can put a price floor anywhere you want, but in order for it to have meaning, in order for it to be binding, the price floor has to go where you don't think a floor is going to go. Meaning, the price floor has to be up here above equilibrium, okay? Now, the price wants to go down, but it can't, okay? Look at the sugar price, price for sugar. We pay double the world price for sugar because the sugar lobby is one heck of a strong lobby in New York. Okay, I'm sorry, in Washington, D.C. All right, inefficiencies. Well, inefficiently low quantity demanded. Now, here we say, well, wait a minute. If this price floor is up here, the suppliers are making it. Yeah, the suppliers are making it. But we as demander, we're not buying it. So it's an inefficiently low quantity demanded. Because we're back here. We don't want to buy that. And you'd say, well, isn't that a surplus then? Under normal circumstances, yes. You would think, well, there's a big surplus. Well, what happens is this surplus, it's bought up by the government. And they either completely destroy it, trash it, or they'll move it to another market and sell it at a huge discount. I mean, you know, taking a big hit. Or, you know, at least some cases they'll make this big box of cheese. At least it can help some poor school districts. I mean, that's something. But the long and the short of it is you've got inefficiently low quantity demanded. Going into that, we have an inefficient sale among sellers. Just as we had an inefficient allocation of goods, you know, among buyers, here we have an inefficient sale among sellers. What that means is, here's where the sellers should be, okay? Producing way up here at this really high price, we are allowing sellers who really aren't that efficient and who absolutely need this really, really high price because their operation is so inefficient, it needs the high price to compensate for their inefficiency. It's allowing them to produce all the way up to here, okay? So that is a sales that we are allowing inefficient producers to have. So that's an inefficient sales among sellers. Wasted resources. Well, wasted resources, what we just talked about. The government buys up the surplus and disposes of it, either completely trashes it, sells it at a discount, or, you know, it'd be nice if it would be nice if all the poor folks got the product. At least you wouldn't feel quite so bad. Inefficiently high quality. Well, if you can't compete on price, the only other, just like the airlines, when they were deregulated, or when they were regulated, they couldn't compete on price. So what else are you going to compete on? You're going to do all these perks, and you're going to take these perks way out of line to where you're bringing in catering meals from Maxim's of Paris for Pan Am Airlines. You've got Irish linen tablecloths. You've got, you know, they're killing us with kindness, so to speak. It's way too much, okay? Now, again, I'm not opposed to having a nice meal on an airplane, but that was back in the 60s. That was going to an extreme. And they did it because they couldn't compete on price, so they did it with all this other, these other amenities. And so, but to the extent that it was inefficient, okay? All right, now, that was inefficiently high quality. Finally, black markets. You know, these producers are producing all this quantity, and what are they doing with it? Well, maybe not all of it's going to the government. Maybe they're siphoning some off and they're selling it here or there, okay? Again, illegal activities. All right, last one, quotas. Problem with quotas. Quotas is not a price control, it's quantity control. And just like the pricing, you can put a quota anywhere you want, but you, to be effective, the quota has to be to the left of the equilibrium. Meaning, back in the 80s, American public wanted 3 million Japanese cars. That's here, all right? But the government was about to institute a quota, which doesn't get as much bad press as a tariff. And the Japanese car makers knew this, so they graciously said, all right, don't pass the quota. Oh, we will do a voluntary quota. Long and short, it was a quota, okay? So instead of getting 3 million, the American public only got 1.8 million Japanese cars. And, you know, that cost the American public, I think I mentioned over the years that was in effect, was around $5 billion. I mean, it was a lot of money, okay? So the two problems with quotas: dead weight loss, because nobody's, you know, they want to buy this many cars, but we're forced back to here. All right, you got that again. Black wedge, okay? And generally speaking, because it's a lower quantity transacted for, okay? And last is illegal activities. You know, you get a lot of unscrupulous dealers. They were taking, and this happened quite a bit, you know, they would take, well, here's the price of the car, and I would appreciate an envelope with maybe $700-$800 or $1,000 in it, in addition to the price of the car. So it gives rise to a lot of illegal activities, okay? So, class, that's it for the first exam. The course does start to get exciting. Now we start opening up into some real macroeconomic terms. I'm going to try to make this even more interesting for you as the weeks go on. But I will try to put up these videos as often as I can and add some other ones as well, just to make the course much more interesting. All right? Well, anyway, you'll be watching this on Wednesday, and Thursday morning, the exam will open. You'll have a lot of days to take it, and 3 hours to finish the exam. Again, please answer all 8 questions, okay? All right, everybody. You take it easy, and I will see you very soon.